The power grid is probably one of the biggest machines on the planet. You probably take it for granted and only start to pay attention to it when it fails. Today I'll show you how you can monitor the power grid of the whole country with a simple device. But before that, let me connect a speaker to the power grid and I'll show you what we're gonna do today. To demonstrate the most fascinating property of the power grid, we need two speakers and a slow motion camera. What I want to demonstrate is frequency synchronization. Here we have two speakers and two light bulbs connected sequentially. Now let's use a slow motion camera. As you can see, the diaphragms of two speakers move in sync. And they're gonna be in sync even if they are located in different parts of the country, as long as they are connected to the same power grid. So the power grid works as one synchronous system. Another important property of the power grid is frequency. It shows the supply and demand balance. In the power grid, the amount of electricity produced should always be equal to the amount of electricity consumed. If you produce less electricity than needed, the generators in the whole power grid start to rotate slower, and the frequency decreases. Maintaining the supply and demand balance is critical for the power grid stability. And that's what we're gonna do today. I'm going to build a device that's going to monitor the frequency of the power grid with very high precision. The idea here is to use an ESP8266 to measure oscillations in the power grid and calculate the frequency. To insulate the ESP8266 from the mains electricity, I'm using an optocoupler. Here is the initial circuit. So let's start building. Let's do everything step by step. First, we need to provide the power for the brain of the whole project. The brain of this project is the ESP8266 board. Its job to measure the power grid frequency and send this data via Wi-Fi to the internet. The board needs 5 volts to operate, so this small power supply should be perfect here. After this simple step is complete, let's check it. We have 5 volts. Perfect. Let's continue. Now let's build the actual circuit that helps ESP8266 detect oscillations in the power grid. There are many ways you can build such detection circuit. You can use a transformer to lower the voltage or use a resistor with an optocoupler. But a transformer would be heavy, and in the case of the resistor it would produce a lot of heat. So I decided to use a capacitor. As you know, a capacitor in the AC circuit can act like a resistor, but unlike a resistor it will not produce heat. Also, in such circuits it's common to add a resistor with a relatively big value, 470k-ohm resistor or 1 mega-ohm resistor in parallel to the capacitor. It's not really necessary for the working of the device. As far as I understand, the only purpose of such resistor is to discharge the capacitor after you disconnect it from the power. So it's more like a safety feature. Now, according to my circuit, we also need to connect 100-ohm resistor sequentially. Now, after this, it's time to connect an LED. It's important to pay attention to the polarity. It should be connected in parallel, but in the reverse direction to the LED that's inside the optocoupler. The LED gonna serve two purposes. The first purpose is to indicate that the device is working, and the second purpose is to limit the reverse voltage across the second LED that's inside the optocoupler. Now it's time for the optocoupler itself. Optocoupler will allow the ESP8266 board to detect the oscillations in the power grid, but at the same time it will electrically insulate the ESP8266 board from the high voltage of the power grid. The output of the optocoupler is connected to the pin D5 and the ground pin of the ESP8266. Now let's solder the optocoupler to the LED. ESP8266 is gonna be programmed with internal pull-up resistor at pin D5. So I don't need any external pull-up resistor for that pin. Now let's do a quick test. And let's continue. And be careful not to touch the device when it's connected to the power. Now let's solder the power connector through which ESP8266 will receive its power. First, let's solder wires to the power supply. And now let's solder the power connector to the wires. Now it's time for the display. We just need 4 wires, 2 wires for the power and 2 for the I2C bus. And now is the first test. At this point I already flushed the ESP8266 with firmware, obviously. And it's working, and even measures the frequency. We're gonna test it more a bit later. Now I'm using a silicone sealant to glue everything together. And in slow motion you can see that the LED is blinking. It's blinking in sync with the power grid's frequency. The same happens with the LED inside the optocoupler. ESP8266 measures the blinking time and calculates the frequency. And if I record the time lapse, we can see the change in the frequency of the power grid of the whole country. Now I want to tell you a little bit about the development of this project. This is the JSON data that this device returns. The frequency measurements are done using interrupts. And when I was developing the project, I started to notice a small number of false interrupts. My code is smart enough because I implemented a filter in the code that ignored all of the false interrupts. And the measurements are very accurate. But I still wanted to make everything right, so I started to investigate more. Luckily at this point I received my new oscilloscope, so understanding the problem became much easier. I found an interesting behavior. At the output of the optocoupler, the rising edge of the signal is fine, but the falling edge is not smooth and has some weird jumps. It took quite some time for me to understand what causes that jump. After analyzing the light from the LED, I understood that it blinks not only 50 times per second, but also has a high frequency component, 100 kHz to be precise. This means that it also slightly blinks 100,000 times per second. So that's why we have that weird jump on the fallen edge of the poles. The only source that could cause high frequency noise in the power grid is the power supply. Power supplies usually use PWM to convert energy, and they use frequencies somewhere in this range. So the power supply of this project is also the source of the interference. So after looking at the circuit again, I understood the problem in my design. The capacitor that I used in this circuit works as a high pass filter, which means it would happily allow any high frequency to pass through it to the optocoupler. But the desired frequency of 50 Hz actually gets reduced. So, after I understood the problem, I decided to make a simple low-pass filter, which should remove all of the high-frequency components. So, this is the final circuit of this project. Now the fallen edge is smooth and no problems are detected. The last step for this device is to build the housing. I decided to use what I had, which is glass, black and white plastic and silicone sealant. Silicone sealant is resistant to high temperatures and doesn't conduct electricity, so it's perfect for this project. I'm using this device for the last 10 months, and for those who don't know, I'm from Ukraine, and my country is going through war, so I detected a lot of historical events with this device. One of the most noticeable events happened on the March 4th, when Russia occupied Zaporizhia nuclear power plant. During that night, I detected the lowest frequency that I ever saw. It was 49.8 Hz. Very low frequency in the power grid usually means a sudden loss of generation capacity in the power grid. And it makes sense. I assume that after hearing shooting and getting reports about fire at the territory of the power plant, the personnel of the nuclear power plant probably started to shut down the power units. So, as you can see, the device can be very useful to monitor the situation in the power grid, especially during times of emergencies. On the March 11th, Ukrainian power grid has been synchronized with Europe's power grids. So now this device here shows frequency not only in Ukraine, but in the whole Europe. And that's all for today. The device works well. The frequency is stable. Stay safe and hopefully see you next time.